I'm Tammy Kolda, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. On this YouTube channel, I'm providing a detailed how-to guide on using TikZ and PGF plots. I'm a longtime user of these tools, so I understand your frustrations. We're working our way through the contents of my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as bonus materials. Please subscribe, post questions, and share with your friends and colleagues. Today's episode will explain a few pain points in using nodes. We'll show how to place nodes along a path midway or a different place along the path, and we'll show how to make it so it doesn't overlap with the path if you've drawn it. Secondly, we'll show how to make the node align with the slope of the path. Finally, we'll talk about how nodes do not automatically inherit the scale and rotation of the path or the picture and how we can fix that. This video assumes a bit of familiarity with TikZ nodes. You can always go back and watch earlier videos linked in the show notes to learn more. As usual, we'll create our document today at overleaf.com. Let me start a new project, blank project. We'll name the project TikZ Node Position Scaling and Rotation Solved. Go ahead and create that. Now I'll clean up a little bit, closing the left-hand side and increasing the magnification of the PDF to 150%. We'll go ahead and add our packages and title and so forth. So we're going to use the package TikZ as always. Today, we'll use the TikZ positioning library because we're going to do some placement of nodes, which we discussed in the last episode, if you want to go back and check that. The parskip and full page packages are just to make things look nice, and hyperref is so that the author name over here will link back to the YouTube channel. First, we'll talk about nodes along a path. I'll create a simple arrow emanating from a point and show you how we can add nodes to that path. So here I have a circle of size 2 PT at the position 0, 0, and then I draw an arrow emanating from that to the position 4, 0. Now, suppose I want to add a node along that path. So I'll go ahead and put node with the text right, R-I-G-H-T, right here, between the dash dash and the final coordinate. Observe that the node that is produced is right in the middle of the path, both horizontally and vertically. First, let's go ahead and move it vertically. I could put it in a position such as above or below. I could even do above right and so on. If we're not too particular, then just using the keyword auto automatically moves the node so that's not overlapping with the line. So here it went ahead and put it above. Where the node goes with auto depends on the path. So I'll add two more lines here. One is drawing a arrow straight down, and then the node down goes on the right of the path. I draw another arrow emanating at the angle of 30 degrees for length 3, and then I'll add a node that has the text 30 degrees here, and that has been positioned above left. I can override the auto with a manual position. So for example, I could change auto here to be left because maybe I don't like it on the right. And so now it put down on the left side of the down facing arrow. It might be a little bit hard to see how the offsets are working. This 30 degrees looks really far away from the line and you might wonder why. So one debugging trick I use is I go ahead and outline every one of my nodes with a little red path so that I can see what's going on. So here I can see that indeed the lower right corner of the 30 degree text is just touching the line. I could probably make things closer by doing an X shift or Y shift or changing the intercept, but we won't worry about that today. Just wanted to give you a sense of how you might go about debugging that. The horizontal position defaults to 50% or midway along the line. We can modify where this is by adding a pause option to the node. So for example, if I want to change where this node right is along this path, I just go ahead and add pause equals 0.8 to make the node 80% along the line, and you see the change here. Now we've seen how the keyword auto makes it so that your node does not overlap the path. However, it does not make the node slope to be lined up with the path. So let's go ahead and start with our prior example again. So I'm just copying what we had and recompiling that. We can make it so that our nodes are angled along with the path by using the option sloped. So let me go ahead and add it here for that node that goes at 30 degrees. So I'll go ahead and put sloped here. And now we see that it looks much nicer because the 30 degrees is going along the line. If I add slope to the down node, then things look a little funny. Now the down is sort of all screwed up because I had left there. It gets confused. So I can change that back to auto. And now it looks a little more reasonable. But you can also do things manually. Maybe instead of auto and sloped, I want it to go the other direction. So I could rotate at 90 degrees and then put above, because after we rotate it, that's when we then apply the above. And so now we have down sort of facing down. Sloped also works along bendy paths. So let me go ahead and paste a bendy path and put sloped on that. Picked out the slope at the point that the node is attached to the path for bend left. And so that is sloped to the tangent with the line at that point. If I, for example, change it to be position 0.7 along the path, now we see that it sloped it differently because it's further along the sloped path. So this is automatically updated as you move. Now let's talk about node scaling. This can be very powerful, but also very frustrating. So let me go ahead and give you an example of a little picture where we might want to use some scaling. What I've created here is a TikZ picture of a small graph. I define two styles. The circ style creates these circular nodes in blue. That'll be the nodes of our graph. The weight style I'll be using on these edge weights for my graph. And then I also went ahead and made every edge to be magenta. So one thing I'll have you observe is that the nodes A and D are both placed at specific coordinates. A is placed at the coordinate 0, 2, and D is placed at the coordinate 3, 0. The other two nodes are placed using the positioning library. So the node B is placed to the right of A, and remember the default distance is 10 millimeters. We reviewed that in the last episode. And the node C is placed 5 millimeters to the right of B. Suppose I want to shrink this picture. This often happens when you're trying to match a page limit in a paper. And so you think, let me just go ahead and scale the entire picture. So I just put scale in a TikZ picture and everything should be fine, right? When I go ahead and compile that, I see that it didn't actually work. So this help lines that I drew is now 70% of its original size. And A and D have been mapped to these new coordinates. But everything else has stayed the same. The size of the nodes hasn't changed. The size of the text hasn't changed. And even the positioning, B is still 10 millimeters to the right of A, and C is still 5 millimeters to the right of B. So this is a problem. The fix is to add something called transform shape. And you can add this to all the nodes that you want to scale. In our case, we want every node to scale. So we can go ahead and add this to every node in our graph. So we use every node and we append the style with transform shape. Now you see that everything has changed. The nodes have scaled to 70% of their original size. The distances that we use with the positioning library is now 70%. So if you were to measure this, it's actually 7 millimeters along. So 70% of our 10 millimeters. And the same change has happened for the second line. So this is a really nice way to scale things, but you need to remember this keyword, transform shape. You also might not want every node to automatically transform, in which case you can apply it on a case-by-case basis. I also note that this would work with rotate, but since we don't normally need to rotate entire pictures, I'm not going to worry about it here. But this can be useful when you're putting sort of a bunch of pictures, sort of want a copy of something, and maybe you want a bunch of rotated copies. I hope you enjoyed today's video. You should know now how to automatically scale and rotate nodes in your diagrams using the keywords auto, sloped, and transform shape. This is the 7th and last video in my sequence on nodes in TikZ. Our next sequence of videos will cover advanced topics in TikZ, so keep an eye out for that. There's a link to the overleaf document we created today in the show notes. Please click like or subscribe if you want more videos like this. You can also buy my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, at your favorite book retailer. Thanks for watching.